And all of a sudden I heard, oh, God, there's a tornado coming in. You know how a tornado is.
Tornado.
And I'm like, I'm about ready to get up. And then, I was sucked out the room. I went, just going. I was going. And I went,
And it went like,
I mean, I literally hollered, I mean, you know, I was sucked out of my room. Just sucked out. And I was, it wasn't right vision. How did you get through the ceiling? I don't know. I just.
And it went like,
I went, I don't know any of that.
Through the roof.
And I went, I was sucked through. I just went through. I'm like the Apostle Paul. I don't know what I was in my body, out of my body. All I know, I went through that room.
Oh my goodness. Like the Apostle Paul doesn't know in the body or out of the body. He was sucked out of the room. Hello, Bezel T3. That was Jesse Duplantis retelling his amazing journey through the roof and then by way of a high-speed celestial gondola up to the third heaven. Now, Jesse wrote a book in 1996 called Close Encounters of a God Kind, which he is happy to sell you along with a CD and DVD for $33. Jesse felt compelled to share this incredible adventure once again at length with his congregation on May 21st, 2021. I did a video on Jesse a while back on this very subject, and I wanted to see if Jesse is able to stick to the script. Let's find out by comparing a year 2000 retelling with this 2021 retelling of his story. We'll pick it up as Jesse exits the celestial sloop and describes what he sees. Let's see.
I walked out and saw mountains and streams and trees and flowers and the fragrances. And when I opened the door, I was in the most beautiful place I ever seen in my entire life. I've never seen reds like that, blues, purples, gold, grays.
Grays?
When I say color, I mean color like I've never seen in my life.
So in 2000, Jesse transmits to us the topography, but in 2021, he tells of the vividness of the colors, although gray is an odd choice. Now here's the first problem. Beautiful surroundings being the first thing that Jesse sees is at odds with what we find in the Bible. Isaiah, he first sees the glory of the Lord in his vision, and he says, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Ezekiel, in his vision, saw God and fell flat on his face. And when the Apostle John, in Revelation, saw the risen and glorified Lord Jesus Christ, he fell at his feet as though dead. But Jesse sees a beatific backwoods. He then talks about watching two classes of people who have died entering into this paradise of pleasantries.
And he was getting his gowns are beautiful. And when I got back to the earth, I began to research it and I found out that God gives us a robe of righteousness and a gown of salvation. There's a difference. And I said, well, they're not going to go to the throne? He said, yes. But he said, the great God Jehovah is merciful. But they didn't live the way they were supposed to live. But the great God Jehovah was merciful. They will learn and eventually get to the throne. And I thought, man, I am something going wrong with me. I'm hearing so. And then when I got back, I checked it out in the book of Isaiah. He said he gives us a garment of salvation and a robe of righteousness, which is totally two separate things.
No, they're not. Isaiah 61:10 tells us, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exalt in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself like a priest with beautiful headdress, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels." You see, these are metaphors, both describing the same condition. They are foreshadowing the perfect righteousness of Christ that brings about our salvation from sin and its wretched consequences. Jesse then says that he was introduced to Abraham, who Jesse claims is the first person that people are greeted by in heaven.
So Abraham's walking with me. He said, "Are you thirsty?" I said, "Yeah. Yeah. And he had a gold goblet in his hand, ladies and gentlemen. And he reached down into that river. It looked like a stream, a very big stream, not like the Mississippi River, but a stream, but pure and clear. He said, drink some water. And I looked at that gold goblet. I went, man, look, I mean, this ain't a plastic cup from Sam's. This is a this is a golden goblet. It was heavy.
He said, you thirsty? I said, yes. He said, let me get you some water. He had a goblet with sapphire and diamond and emerald. I thought, my God, look at that cup.
So was it a heavy, solid gold goblet, or was it a precious jewel-encrusted golden goblet? Well, maybe that's not such a big deal. So let's give old Jesse a pass on this one. Jesse will now tell of his encounter with the now glorified Lord Jesus, the Christ.
Jesus is between 5'11 and about 6'1".
And he's between 5'11 and 6'1".
Okay. Jesse got Jesus' height down pat. So let's see what else he says.
And he put his hand on this shoulder. And he looked at me. He said, go tell my people I'm coming. And I thought he was going to give me a great... I said, and he would answer me when I thought. I said, they know that. He said, no, they don't know that. Don't tell them I'm coming. I brought you here to tell you. Go tell them I'm coming.
Okay, now, first I find Jesse's facial expressions quite disturbing because he is betraying what Jesus was telling him and how he was telling him. Second, why would Jesus need Jesse Duplantis to tell Christ's people that he is coming? For we read in John chapter 10, verses 27 and 28, my sheep hear my voice. And we're going to know down the line that that is from God's revealed word. We know his voice, we who are Christ's. He says, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will be able to snatch them out of my hand. Now, what comes next is a problem for old Jesse as he relates what Jesus tells him.
He said, there's many things you shall see here and learn, but I brought you here to tell you that go tell my people I'm coming. And he turned around. He took me by the hand.
Okay.
He said, I want you to meet another king. And I saw a man walking toward me. And he had reddish hair.
Okay.
And he had a red beard, and it was a beard about this wide, coming like this.
Okay. All right.
And I knew him immediately. I just knew it.
Oh, okay. Now, did you catch that? Jesus is leading Jesse by the hand to meet another king who turns out to be King David. But what does Jesse say in 2021?
He said, you have an appointment with my Father and me and my spirit. I said, well, let's talk now. He said, you have to see other things. I'll meet you soon. And he walked off as the kids were singing.
So here, Jesse tells us that Jesus walks off and leaves him with the angel that was in the glory-powered gondola with him. Then what happened, Jesse?
But then I see them people with gowns step out, go over, and they would grab those leaves. And I asked the angel again, I said, and they're not going to go. He said, the great God Jehovah is merciful.
Okay, so now with this angel, he again tells of seeing the second-class saved souls in gowns taking nose hits off of heavenly sky shrubs. And then this happens.
And he put that in the book, and he told me, I said, okay. I said, listen, I want to watch. He said, no, I have to keep moving you.
Okay, so keep in mind, that's the angel that's moving Jesse along during this delusional day trip.
And that's when David came up to him. I looked at him, and he had a red beard like Keith Moore's beard.
Keith Moore.
It wasn't shaggy, it was very well manicured. You never seen beards. And he goes, hello, Jesse. Everybody knew my name.
You know what? Wait just a second here. I thought you said back in 2000.
And he turned around. He took me by the hand. He said, I want you to meet another king. I saw a man walking toward me, and he had reddish hair.
So, Jesse, did Jesus introduce you to King David, or did he not? The 2000 version of your story says he did, but the 2021 version says that Jesus was long gone by the time you met King David. You see, even if you write a fictional story and practice real hard to get the story straight, over time, and especially with age, you're gonna mess it up, as we can see Jesse clearly did here. As if it really matters. I mean, this whole story is made up. And the clearest evidence I have for saying that is the fact that Jesse describes people like Abraham and King David as physical human beings on the earth. He says that the children singing around Jesus have spiritual bodies, borrowing from 1 Corinthians 15. And you know, you might take some time and look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 35 through 49, which clearly likens our bodies as a seed that is sown in the ground when we die as a natural body and then comes back to life when we are resurrected as a spiritual body, glorified. But folks, the bodily resurrection of the dead that Paul speaks of there hasn't happened and will not happen until the last day at the return of Jesus Christ in glory. Jesse will now descend into the most dangerous of places. He begins to fiddle with the very inner workings of the mind of God.
He said, "The worst day of my life is yet to come." He was talking with, all of a sudden, the Lord Jesus Christ, God, is sharing with his creation.
You know, Jesse wants us to believe that Jesus confided in him and told him that the worst day of his life is yet to come. This is going to be bad. This is going to be real bad.
He said, "You know that scripture I said that I will wipe away all tears in heaven?" I said, "You know, Lord, I never truly understood that. You know, I mean, in some ways I did, in some ways I didn't." He says, "That's tears in my eyes, Jesse."
Oh, man. Go to Isaiah 25, verse 8. It foreshadows that most glorious and wonderful day. We read there, "He will swallow up death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face and remove the disgrace of his people from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken." Fast forward to Revelation 7, and we see this new heavens and earth language as well. We read there, "For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." And then, of course, the same scene is recapitulated in Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. Where we read, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning or crying nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." These are not the shed tears of the glorified Savior, but rather the last tears that will ever be shed by the redeemed. So why on earth would Jesse say what he is saying? Well, here is the reason, folks, as we fast forward to 2021.
I was going to dismiss you, and the Lord spoke to me about receiving an offering. I said, "I don't want to do that." He said, "I'm not asking what you don't want to do." "I'm yours to command. I'm going to ask you to help me so Jesus don't have to cry no more."
You know, they're not words to describe the depth of deception this man has been willing to submerge himself. He continues.
"You give me $1,000, I'll get 1,000 people saved. You give me $1,000,000, I'll get 1,000,000 people saved. I know I can do it. I'm bragging because I'm under command."
Wow. Jesse claims that he can save people for $1 a soul. That has got to be the epitome of prosperity preacher vainglory right there. You know, I'm still trying to wrap my head around a supposed Christian pastor boasting in such a way. So much for Jesus declaring, "It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh counts for nothing." John 6, verse 63.
"The worst day of my life is yet to come, when I have to tell my creation, you can't come."
Getting
I'm trying to stop that. Not all people get saved, I know that, but I'm going to do my best to make it happen.
You know, poor Jesus sitting there with his feet dangling over the edge of heaven, waiting and hoping that Jesse can get the dollars he needs to save the same amount of souls. Oh, and that at the same time, finally get that Falcon 7X to replace that tiny, old, beat-up Falcon 50 with N number November 770 Juliet Delta, which stands for Jesse Duplantis, of course, that he's still forced to ride around in. He's waiting.
This is going to be tough on Jesus. But we can make it a lot less if we'll just honor him. So I'm going to ask you to give if you'd like to, and if you don't want to, you don't have to.
That's painful.
I leave that to you. I just want to let you know that I'm going to use it 100% for world evangelism. There's an offering envelope at the back of the pew if you want to use that. Or if you want to give, and you
world evangelism
somewhere in Israel.
An excuse to use the airplane.
China. You can use PayPal if you want to, or you go to JDM website. JDM.org, or you can text the give.
Mm-hmm. You know, I've come to find out that the pastor who gives more and more ways to give, well, that exemplifies the greediness of that particular false teacher. Now, two things I want you to ponder as we wrap this up. The first thing is this. Trips to heaven by anyone, be they super special super apostles like Jesse, who gets sucked up into heaven through the roof of their hotel room, or the new crop of heavenly tourists who have to flatline first before their tour begins, are telling us the same thing. And that is that God's revealed word is not sufficient, and we need new revelation to keep our faith alive. You know, they're forgetting some of the last words of the book of Revelation, where we read, "I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book."
I was flying at 41,000 feet the other night. I said, "Boy, good time to come is now. I'll get there before anybody else will." I think about that constantly. When I'm up in that plane flying 43,000, Lord, Jesus, come on.
Mm-hmm. I'll bet he is. I'll bet he's up there every second saying, "Lord Jesus, come," you know, because he's suffering for the Lord in that plush private jet. Now, the second thing I want you to think about is this. Jesse wants to, he wants you to help financially so Jesus doesn't have to cry no more. And by saying that, he is denying the attribute of God's infinitely perfect righteousness and holiness, which by extension, it includes God's just judgment and wrath against all evil. God's wrath is an essential and appropriate response to moral objective evil. J.I. Packer wrote in his book, Knowing God, "Would a God who took as much pleasure in evil as he did good be a good God? Would a God who did not react adversely to evil in his world be morally perfect? Surely not. But it is precisely this adverse reaction towards evil, which is a necessary part of moral perfection, that the Bible has in mind when it speaks of God's wrath. In Nahum chapter 1, verse 2, we read, "The Lord is a jealous and avenging God. The Lord is avenging and full of wrath. The Lord takes vengeance on his foes and reserves wrath for his enemies." And in Deuteronomy 7, verse 10, "But those who hate him, he repays to their faces with destruction. He will not hesitate to repay to his face the one who hates him."
The worst day of my life is yet to come, when I have to tell my creation, "You can't come."
But some of you might be saying, "Well, that's the bloodthirsty God of the Old Testament." Mm-mm. The God of the Old Testament is the same God of the New Testament. Look at Romans chapter 2, verse 5. "But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourselves on the day of wrath, when God's righteous judgment will be revealed." John's vision of Christ's second coming has no room for a crying Jesus. Revelation chapter 19, 11 through 16. "Then I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, and its rider is called Faithful and True. With righteousness he judges and makes war. He has eyes like blazing fire and many royal crowns on his head. He has a name written on him that only he himself knows. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, And his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven, dressed in fine linen, white and pure, follow him on white horses. And from his mouth proceeds a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God, the Almighty. And he has a name written on his robe and on his thigh. And what's there? King of kings and Lord of lords.
Amen and amen. Ushers, go ahead and receive tonight's offering. As you're doing that, in just a minute, we'll have a book signing. If you can give me about 10 minutes, I got to go change shirts, kind of wet, and things of that nature.
Oh, man. If Jesse knew what lies ahead for false teachers like himself, who lie about trips to heaven and deny the essential attributes of God, he would be needing to change his undershorts right about now.
Wandering stars, for whom it is reserved, blackness, darkness, wandering stars, for whom it is reserved, blackness, darkness.